above names, worthy of all his praise. That still ain't enough, yeah. You don't know how hard I prayed, and he looked in my grave and he told me get up. I can't be set back, ready, set, go. Yeah, he made me ready, he set me up, then told me go.
Come a little closer, so we can. Worship God in spirit and in truth. I'm not here to rebuke you. I am here to remind you that even with it being cold outside, even with bills not being paid, even with prayers go unanswered, he's still worthy of all the glory and worthy of all the praise. And it's being in his presence. The song that says the safest place in the whole wide world is in the will of God. So all I'm saying is that even when you don't feel it, you got to remind yourself of what the word says. Come on, let's worship God. Lift your hands all over this place. Lift your hands, close your eyes.
At the mention of your name, every knee will bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord.
Can we please pause? We don't have to stop the music, but listen. Let me tell you what I feel in the spirit realm. I know why it's heavy, and I know why we're distracted, and that's fine, but we have the power to shift atmospheres. So I need you not to be stingy with your worship this morning. Even if you're not there, you don't know how somebody else needs it. And I want you to turn this place that we're in into God's sanctuary. So even if that means you got to get out of your seat, whatever you got to do that's stopping you from lifting your hands and closing your eyes, so we can have a collective worship experience, because we can't afford for people to come in here and not get their life changed. Here we go.
At the mention of your name,
say
every tongue confess that
you are.
At the mention of your name,
every tongue come.
You are.
Y'all believe that this morning?
Oh, say at the mention of the name.
You believe that? Come on, lift Put your hands all over this sanctuary. It's our sanctuary right now. Say at the mention of your name. Every tongue comes.
Strife. He promised to keep me, never to
embrace that like that's real. Say, God is hey.
God is
again.
call you, it's almost like I want to call you my big sister, but we're kind of like the same. We're like twins. You always tell me because you're a first lady, you're living through me, because I am you. I'm the younger version of you. We always talk about you from the beginning of you becoming a first lady till now. And it's a lot. And I always tell you, I always say, I could never be a first lady. And because it's a lot that you wear on your shoulders, but you wear it with so much pride, and you wear it with a lot of dignity, and you don't let it frustrate you. And that's the one thing that I love about you. You're always the same. And more so than that, you love my son the way I love my son. I know that if there was someone I could leave my son with, I could leave my son with you, and you would raise my son the way I raised my son. So that's one thing that I am always indebted to you. Even when you're at the shop with us, which you know we keep you up there all day, Pastor No, once you come to the salon, you stand forever. Every time I tell my son no, you tell my son yes. Every time I say, okay, I'm not taking you, Lady K take him. And that's just something that people don't do. So I really, 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 really enjoy you. I enjoy being around you. I respect you. And you know I don't play about you. You're probably one of my favorite people walking this earth. And I understand that people love you through Apostle, but I actually love Apostle through you. Because there's so much stuff that you've shown me. There's so much stuff that you've taught me that you don't know that I use every day. Even things of business, I use that every single day because you've been in the business that I'm in. Even professional level things, we talk about giving people passes. I give a lot of passes nowadays because I honestly have a really big mouth. And it's just so much stuff that you've given. It's so much stuff that you've poured into my life that you probably don't see. But I just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. I love you. I love you forever. And thank you, Apostle, for bringing this woman to the church, to bring her into our life, because she's been nothing but grace since the first day she stepped in here.
Lady K, you're very nice, and you're a kind, beautiful soul, and we love you so very much.
That's a lot for Cayenne. Thank you. Amen. Amen. Awesome. The ladies, if Keisha would come, the ladies have a presentation that they want to share. Now, or you want to wait? Okay, come on. That's mine? Okay. Let me see.
Press y'all know I'm loud without this.
You need that talk.
Boom, boom. Okay. So, good morning, everybody. We blessed you already, right? So, but today, so we're not presenting from ourselves, period. But we want to do this blessing on behalf of Theola. She could not be here, okay? But she wanted to make sure that she showed her appreciation to tell you she loves you enduringly. So she brought this bouquet of coins, dollar bills, to say she loves you. She sent them.
Awesome. 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 Pager, come. Page, my God, come on. And then we're going to be blessed by a dance. So you can get ready, Ashley.
helped me so much, and I can't thank you enough for that. You are always there for me. You always find time for me.
The moments we have together are so unforgettable. You are always trying your best to fulfill my needs.
Because that's who you taught me to be. You are always giving the best advice. Your words are always repeating in my head because sometimes I need a reminder. You have helped me with some of my biggest situations to my biggest problems. It doesn't matter if it is about school, life, or fashion. You are always there by my side. We have grown so much together. Our bond gets stronger and stronger every day. You're always reminding me about how smart, entertaining, beautiful, and energetic I am. I know you have my back, and I most definitely have yours. We may not be related by blood, but we are by heart. Happy birthday, Mommy. I love you.
Not your turn yet. I swear, I pastor this church. She just, it never fails. I pastor this church. Mama, you just, no, don't she do me like that. Y'all always talking about, don't do her like that. Let's receive and be blessed by a dance by Ashley. Come on, Ash.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. If Reagan would come. She said, "How do you preach up here? It's so bright."
Morning. For starters, if you didn't know who I am, my name is Reagan K. Martin. And if you also didn't know, tomorrow is a special day for someone else we know and love. Some may know her as Lady K, Coach K, or Pastor Christy. What's tomorrow that has to do with Pastor Christy, you may be asking? Well, tomorrow is Pastor Christy's 50th birthday. And if I know if you ask anybody in this room, they'll say she doesn't look a day over 30. And I'll agree, but she's so much more than looking younger than twice her age. If you know me, then you know I adore reading and mythology, excuse me. But not just any mythology, I love Greek mythology. So when I asked Pastor Christie if she was willing enough to read Percy Jackson, I was shocked when she was up for the challenge. That's what I look up to. She really tries to use her time to read those books or watch those movies when I ask. That's why she's so blessed and so important. And I know she's made mistakes, and I know she's different, but not all keys play the same note. Not all birds have the same melody. And I may not know her as well as Apostle or her family does, and we may not be blood, but she knows that I love her, and I always will. Happy birthday, Pastor Christie.
Amazing. Amazing articulation. Amazing. Amen. I want Eddie to come. If I let the day go by in the editing scene, and I'd have to deal with her at home.
Thank you, man. And you got me all the way down here.
You're not preaching right now. You are just, this is a... So don't come fixing stuff on my altar.
Mom, I wrote you something, and it's called I See You. I've always saw you, and in the 11 years of calling you my mom, I never saw you any differently. I saw you sit in silence knowing that you had a voice the entire time. But I still heard you because I never lost sight of you. I saw you sacrifice emotionally when I know you didn't have the emotional wherewithal to give it at the time. You still gave, and I was able to see this because I never lost sight of you. I saw you create a map for others to walk into their purpose, whether it be in marriage, entrepreneurship, or just life. I saw you create a map for them and me when you weren't sure of the map that was laid out for you. I saw you be a mom when you needed one. I saw you be a sister when you needed one. I saw you be a friend when you needed one, and I saw you be an ear when you yourself needed one. I saw you be a shoulder when you needed one, and I saw you be strength when you needed some. And I believe that my purpose in your life was to simply be a son who was willing to be an ear, be a shoulder, strength, and safe place whenever you needed it. I was able to be those things because I always knew where to find you. I could find you because I could always see you. Even in spite of all of that, I still see you today. I see you how Jesus saw that woman who had been caught in the act. And when some were ready to stone her, he took a risk to defend her because he saw her for who she was, a daughter. Jesus told her to go, and he is also telling you here in this year of your life, go. Go and be free. Go and become. Go and live to your fullest potential, and go and let the entire world experience Christie's light. I tell you, Mom, that this is a year that your light will shine brighter than ever. So I didn't come with a gift in hand, but what I do have to offer you is my heart, and I hope that you receive it.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Let me show you why times like this are important, because oftentimes people don't know how you feel about them till what is too late, till they're dead. You know, at the funeral, everybody wants to say something during the 2 minutes that they didn't say while the person was alive. And so this is good, and I purposely omitted immediate family because we're going to celebrate her with our own special way on Monday. And again, she is not going to run out after service. She's going to hang. So last week she didn't feel well. That's why she left and was in the bed till Wednesday or so. But she's going be here for you to hug and embrace so you don't have to feel like you were left out. She's going to be here too. And as she always does, to just meet people, talk to people, embrace and love on you. So again, I'm so grateful for a church that loves my wife. I really am. So I want to do a few more things, and then I'm going to put y'all off that front row, you and your sister right there in a few minutes. Every time y'all, I put her lower down on the list. I want Danielle is coming with the spoken word, and then for our guests, we don't usually have all this stuff before the word, but today is special, and we want to make time for that. And then right after that, YOLO is coming, and then I thank my mama coming after that. I thank she coming.
Hey. Truth be told, I don't like you. I don't like how you challenge me. I don't like how you expose me to emotions I prefer in hiding. I don't like how you relate to me and pushing me outside of my normality and impracticality. Your goofiness to the extreme, matching your witty personality. I don't like you because I love you, Miss Light. Or should I say Miss Cyrus, the name of the brightest star in the galaxy, shining your light so bright to be seen even though you're 60 trillion miles away from gravity. Or what about follower of Christ, which suits you because it is your name? The follower who serves to the best of her ability and live life with no shame. The human who exposes her good along with her bad, being a walking example that prayer is never in vain. Or what about Miss Key, the perfect pitch to a melody that flows to the heart of man, bringing joy and prosperity. Or the key to unlock hearts because of your warm personality. You know what? I'm going to call you Christ's Key, because you are the key Christ molded and created to be perfectly you. A rarity that is completely priceless, because no amount could come close to how much we value you. You are a wonderful human being, and I simply love you for you. I don't like you because I love you. Happy birthday to you.
What size them J's? That's what I like. YOLO, come. They wanted to present something. I'm going to preach, y'all. Just hang tight. I promise you there is a word from the Lord. You want to come up here or down? Giving her flowers, go right there. Okay.
Good morning. So we wanted to present you with a token of love. I know it's YOLO and this is supposed to be Apostle's baby, but you don't know that even when you've come in our sessions, when you're here, when we call you, whenever we need you, you are who you are to us, and that is Trigger K, Coach K, Pastor K, Christy, when you're just being you. We want you to know that we love you, we see you, and we thank you. And we want more of you in 2024.
That's it. Amen. All right, let's go to the word. Come on.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. The heart of her husband does safely trust in her. So she shall love, and she have no need of spoil. She would do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She spittled wool and flax and worked willingly with her hands. She is like the merchant ship. She bring her food from afar. She rise up also while it is night and giveth meat to her household. And a portion to her maidens, she considered a field, and she buy it. With the fruit of her hands, she planted a vineyard. She girded her loins with strength, and strength her arms. She perceived that her merchandise is good. Her cannon goeth not out at the night. She laid her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. She stretched out her hands to the poor. She reached forth her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow, for her household and for her household are clothed with scarlet. She maketh herself covering of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the hand. She maketh fine linen and sell it, and deliver girdles unto the merchant. She's strength and honor are her clothing. And she shall rejoice in time to come. She opened her mouth with wisdom. In her tongue is the law of kindness. She looked well to the ways of her household and eateth not the bread of idols. Her children arise up and call her blessed. And her husband also. And he praised her. Many daughters have done virtuous, but thou exceedest them all. Chris, I just wanted to say, Pastor K, Trigger K, Chris, is that I love you. And I want you to know, yes, you are this Proverbs 31 woman. And yes, you are Esther. For such a time as this, for Joshua's generation. And oh, yes, indeed, this is your time. No matter what the enemy tried to do you, this is your time. This is your time. And I know I speak for Joshua's generation. We are behind you 100%. Whatever you have to do, however you have to do it, we are here for you. I don't care what it is, we are here for you. We love you and we appreciate you. I love you so much. I thank God for you being an apostle's life. I really do. All that he went through, you bring life to him. You bring joy to him. And I thank God for you, no matter what. And don't you let no devil in hell try to change your mind or try to tell you what you're not. You know who you are. You know you are. And I love you. And this is a token. You hear what I said, right? A token for me and Papa.
Amen. I want to do this real quick. I want to share, you know, beginning of the year, I challenged you with a sacrificial supernatural seed, and many of you did it, and it's on the way, or it might have already manifest in the name of the Lord. And then last Wednesday, thank you so much. Y'all showed up big for me, and I appreciate you. Amen. And with my brother, Isaiah chapter 40, one of my favorite chapters, passages of scripture. How many believe the word of God can shift your life? I said, how many believe the word of God can shift your life? Isaiah chapter 40, verse 1. Isaiah, can you shift that monitor my way? They messed me up, this praise team I have. Yes, thank you. Isaiah 40, chapter 40, verse 1. Comfort ye, my people, saith your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned. For she hath received the Lord's hand double for all her sins. Verse 3. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Verse 4. Every valley shall be exalted. Every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. Verse 7, the grass wither, the flower faded, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. The grass wither, the flower faded, but the word of the Lord, the word of God shall stand forever. Verse 28. Hast thou not known? Have you not heard? That the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of heaven, the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is he weary. Lord, help me. There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint. And to them that have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fail. But they that wait upon the Lord, I said, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be. They shall walk and not faint. I said, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Glory be to God. I want to talk for a few moments from this subject. I have a prophetic word for he that have an ear, let him hear. Message today is coming soon. Coming soon. I feel that all in my spirit. Coming soon. Remain standing. Let's pray. Father, I thank you. It is the entrance of your word that giveth light, and it lighteth our path. The grass wither, the flower fade, but your word is forever established. For these few moments, speak to us. Empower us. Don't entertain us. Make us better. Shift our life. And we give you praise for this word in Christ's name. Hug somebody before you see it. Tell them, sit down, it's preaching time. You may be seated in the presence of God. Coming soon. I think one of the challenges that we have, you may be seated, ushers and greeters and security, thank you for serving. One of the challenges we have today is waiting on God. It is a perplexing statement and almost makes you question the statement, because to imply that we're waiting on God would suggest that God is behind our schedule. It's challenging for me to wait because I know God can do anything but fail. It's difficult to wait because I've seen him work in other people. Seen him save others' children. I've seen him deliver other people. I've seen him make ways out of no ways. And it's challenging to see God make ways for other people while you're waiting for him to make the way for you. Oh, you can be honest. It's challenging. How long am I supposed to wait? When will my time manifest? When will I not hurt anymore? When will God redeem my marriage? When will God save my children? When will God do what I know he's capable of doing? It's challenging because God is not subjected to our timeline. That's what you're struggling with. God doesn't know, or there isn't a reference in heaven that your rent is due on the first. There's no first in heaven. First was made for earth. So the challenge is, when does God step out of eternity and manifest for me on the first? Or should I not focus on the first? Or should I focus on developing my faith muscle so I don't wait for the first? You're going to get that. You're going to get that on the ride home. You're going to be talking about, that makes sense. Because when your faith muscle is fully working, the first doesn't matter. When do I get to that place to when he heals me and I'm not waiting for the healing? When do I get to that place to where I'm fully delivered and not waiting till I stop doing something that I know doesn't please God? When does it manifest? When does he turn around the mess that I've made of my life? When should I be frustrated with God for the consequences of my own actions? Do I blame God for situations that happen that God doesn't control? Because contrary to what a statement that you've heard, God is not in control. I know, sit there. I got your attention, lean forward. Because you make that statement so many times, God is in control. If God is in control, he would have stopped you marrying who you divorced from. If God was in control, then you wouldn't have gone to a place that you had no business being, that ended up being the worst place you can be because danger hit your life. If God was in control, he would have prevented you from having sex with the person that messed your life up. If God was in control, then he would have stopped you from coming. The fact of the matter is, God is not in control. If he was in control, then we wouldn't be humans, we'd be robots. The reason we declare God is in control is because you want to remove yourself from the responsibility of the sin. I know you don't like that. Oh, God took my uncle away. No, your uncle couldn't stop smoking cigarettes and develop lung cancer, and you're not going to stand up at the funeral and blame God because your uncle wouldn't stop. How much is he in control? How much is on God and how much is on me? Where do I balance the negligence or the responsibility before you start saying, this is what I love about God? Is I love about God is that he is a gracious God. This is why I love him, because if he was going to be cutthroat and deal with people like you deal with them, then don't exclude yourself from dealing with you in the time that he gave you grace when you should have got your just reward. I can't get three people in here to help me. I'm so glad when other people are in trouble, in sin, I'm praying, Lord, give them grace to get themselves together, because I remember me. Matter of fact, I know me. Not remember. I know what I'm doing that I need grace with. And how dare you rush God to get somebody else together and be patient with your own mess. Stay right there. I'm going somewhere. Because you will never get what you prayed for until you settle in the fact that God has already been good. Oh, God. This, That God has already, I wish I had three people who realize that God has already, I may not have the house. I may never get the house I want, but God is already good. Even if he does not make me feel the way I need, God has already been good. Even if I'm not healed like I'm supposed, God has already been good. Even if I don't drive the car that I should drive, God has already been good. When you get the mindset that God has already been good, then he starts blessing, start overtaking you. Don't touch nobody who's mad with God, but touch somebody, tell them God's already been good. God's already been good. Matter of fact, don't sit next to nobody who's mad with God and got issues with people and dilemma, because it might fall on you. Overflow blessings fall on you, and overflow issues fall on you too. And if I got my own issues, I don't need yours too. How do I wait and smile? How do I wait and celebrate with people who got theirs while I'm waiting on mine? I wish I had a real church. How do I wait and keep my expectations high when I feel like he's let me down on other occasions? No, just lean this way. Just the honest people. Sometimes it look like God taking too long. Sometimes it look like I done already given enough. Sometimes it look like I prayed long enough. I done invested. I done put my time in. The saints of God had an old song that says, put your time in, because payday's coming after a while. I know you ain't been saved long enough. But when will it happen? I got good news for the three people who are with me. I got good news. I heard a word from the Lord about a week ago, and he said, dropped in my spirit, he said, coming soon. You know that if there's a movie that you're anticipating on watching and you can't wait, they just put it up and say, coming soon. May I tell you that what you've been believing God for, it is coming. I need 50 prophetic people to hop up on your feet and shout, coming soon. If you've ever believed me as a prophetic voice in your life, if I'm not a prophetic voice in your life, find somebody else who is. But this day, I stand with apostolic assurance that what you've been believing God for and that lines up with his will, it is coming soon.
Your response is, I receive it. Now let me do some work and show you how it's going to happen. The Bible declares, he goes in the first verse, he says, comfort ye, comfort ye. He does not have a stuttering problem, or he's not saying it twice because you are hard of hearing, but two times, twice is the sign of covenant. If you're taking notes, prophetically declare, it's my covenant season. Yeah. What do you mean by covenant season? Hey, write this down. Exodus 3 and 4, he comes up to Moses and he says, Moses, Moses. Because he was walking in the desert, Moses had low self-esteem, insecurity, a fugitive on the run. You think your life is bad. Moses was a fugitive. He was in culture shock. There was a language barrier. He didn't know what was going on. He was living with somebody else. Have you ever had to live with somebody else because you ain't have nowhere to stay? Moses understands. He was living with somebody else. He lost his house, he lost his status, he lost his dignity, he lost his security, he lost everything, staying with somebody else, look just happy to be alive, walked by, saw a burning bush. It wasn't strange to see burning bushes because it was the desert, but what blew his mind and captivated his attention was that the bush was not consumed, and within the bush a voice came out that said, Moses, Moses. And the reason it came out, because he was saying, I made a covenant with the people of God, and now it's time for me to cash in on that covenant. May I suggest to you, the reason I declare coming soon, because God's about to cash in on the covenant that he made with you, and it is coming to pass. Shake a neighbor hand. I feel like preaching this morning. Shake a neighbor hand like they owe you some money and say, neighbor, it's about to come to pass. It's my covenant season. Some of you made a covenant 15 years ago when you got saved, and you think God forgot about it. He didn't forget about it. He didn't forget about it. What I love about God is that he does not forget about it or catch amnesia. Some of y'all made a covenant as kids, backslid, shook what your mama gave you, slept with people, got high, got drunk, did your own thing, and now you got back saved. And he said, I remember what I said to you when you came to me and you were pure. Just because you had a bad season and did some stuff don't mean that God reneges on his covenant. Somebody shout, it shall come to. Genesis 22 verse 11, Abraham was just trying to obey God, and he's on the mountain, hot dog, I feel like lifting him up. And he goes there and he says he's getting ready to obey God and kill his son. And a voice came from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. Again, Abraham wasn't hard of hearing. God didn't have a stuttering problem, but he was declaring to him, I made a covenant with you, and I told you that your seed shall be blessed. I want to talk to every parent. Can I prophesy to you? Every parent, every other parent, every parent in here, or if you call yourself a step parent or whatever, God parent, may I tell you that God, you're about to cash in on your covenant. What he said about your child, it shall come to pass. I need 52 people. If you will get out the way, you don't have to be mad. You don't have to be frustrated. All you've got to do is give God glory in the midst of this service and say, God, you promised me that if I train up a child in the way they should go. It's covenant. Acts chapter 9 verse 4, the Bible declares that Saul, who would later be changed to Paul, was going down the Damascus road, and here he is killing Christians, he is destroying the scripture, he's mad, he's angry, he's a gangster out of his mind, and he's walking down the road, and God says, Saul, Saul, again, he was not hard of hearing, Saul was not hard of hearing, and God didn't have a stuttering problem. What he was saying is, I made a covenant with the Gentiles, and now I'm ready to cash in on my covenant. You know what a Gentile is. That's me and you. It's a heathens. We're heathens. You're not no black Hebrew. You was not born in Israel. You ain't no black Jew. You was born right over there on Mercy Drive, over there in Little Egypt, over there in Richmond Heights, wherever you from, in Orlando, Chicago, New York, whatever. You are not from Israel. You're a Gentile just like me. But thanks be unto God that he touched Saul so that we can have redemption. It's a covenant. And then he goes to Matthew chapter 27 verse 46. Jesus is on the cross at the worst season of his life. People, watch this, people who he helped were crucifying him. People who he was dying for was dogging him out. Folks he was standing for wasn't liking him. He's on the cross, didn't know that the soldier pierced him in the side, he was dying from him. The one that put the crown on his head, he was dying for him. The one that beat him unrecognizably, he was dying for them. And here he is on the cross. He says, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. It was to me, my God, why has thou forsaken me? Again, he was not hard of hearing and he was not stuttering. The reality is he was going through the worst season of his life and he was shouting to his father, but you made a covenant with me that I would be able to get through this. And I want to talk to everybody who's going through a tough season and look like you're about to cave in and look like you're about to lose your mind and look like you're about to go crazy. God made a covenant with you, and the struggle that you seen yesterday, you will not see no more forever. I need me 35 people in here who believe that the storm is over to open up your mouth and give them praise like the storm. That's the wrong neighbor. Touch three people, shout, the storm is over. Like you scared of the devil and his mother-in-law. Touch somebody else and tell them, I tell you, my storm is over. My money storm, my marriage storm, my parent storm, my job storm, my body storm. It is over. wish I had 15 prayer warriors. I feel like kicking some devil, but can you give the devil a nervous breakdown and holler out your faith belly and begin to give God glory right there? Just shout, just shout, just shout, just shout. Sit down, I'm going somewhere. Coming soon. Coming. It won't happen until you acknowledge the covenant. Sometimes you have to stop crying and say, God, you promised me. Sometimes you have to stop chasing your children down and say, but God, you promised me. Sometimes you have to stop fussing and arguing and say, but God, you promised me that many are the afflictions of the righteous. But the Lord. I think I came for two people today, and I came to get you. And I came to declare that it is coming soon. Watch this. He goes in the text and he goes down to verse 3. And the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. I know you thought John the Baptist was the first person that said it, but he was reciting this text. And he was declaring the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness. The Lord told me to tell you, this is how you're going to see the full manifestation. Number two, you have to realize you're not alone. Write that down on your paper. I am not alone. Because the first trick that the enemy likes to do is to make you feel like you're the only one struggling with that. Oh, God, I'm going to help you. You're not the only one. All of you in here who are single and messed up and fornicate, you're not by yourself. I'm just going to look forward. You're not alone. All the children in children's church, you're not alone. You're not the first who messed up, and you won't be the last who messed up. You're not the first who questioned God. You're not the first who fell off the wagon. You're not the first who backslid. You're not the first who went through a season. You're not the first to struggle. You are not by yourself. But here is one of the things you have to understand. Because when you put yourself into that category of you're the only one going through, then what the enemy does is he makes you box yourself in loneliness, and when you are by yourself, he whoops your tail. Has anybody in here ever got your tail whooped by the devil because you secluded to isolation and you took yourself away from people who loved you, and you backed yourself in the corner and you closed the blinds, put the phone on do not disturb, didn't want to deal with anybody, and you got deeper and deeper into your struggle? I came to snatch you up out of this isolated place you put yourself in, that you are not by yourself. The challenge is that you've been fighting alone all your life. And people won't understand you that I have to, you've told yourself I have to do this by myself so long that you started doing it by yourself. You told yourself you can't trust people for so long because you've had two or three people who stab you in the back, but there are 70 people who will stand and support you. So you focused on the two people who stabbed you in the back. Why would you give your energy to two when there are 70 who love you? Say it with a clear voice. I am not by myself. Voice of him crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. The text says, bless me, he says, every valley, verse 4, shall be exalted. Every mountain shall be made low. This is what I call kingdom alignment. This is where you got to hold your weave. Hold your weave. Don't let your track slip. Don't let your track slip while you shout. Hold your weave. This is the point. That kingdom alignment. Those who were here and they were there unlawfully and you were down here that's getting ready to be an alignment. Man, I'm trying to help three people. Habakkuk knew it. He says, why does the wicked
prosper while we struggle in obscurity? Why do it look like doing dirt get them better? And then here I'm trying to live holy and I keep being done wrong and jacked up. I came to prophesy to you that the alignment is coming. If you don't move, if you don't quit, you're going to see them going down and you're going to see yourself coming up. Can I shout you? It's getting ready to happen this year. You're going to see an adjustment. Keep on doing good. It's going to pay off. Keep on being integral. It's going to pay off. Keep on loving your spouse. It's going to pay off. Keep on loving your kids. Bless them. I talk to my kids now. You know how sometimes you get mad with your kids. You don't talk to them. I talk to them while I'm mad with them, while I'm frustrated with them, every day, because I believe the word of God more than my efforts. And I know that if I train them up, it may not happen now. It may not happen next year. But thanks be unto God that his word is true, that eventually they're going to be doing what God says. So I love them in season and out of season. I talk to them in season and out of season.
Gotta work the word till it works. For his word won't return unto him void, but it shall accomplish that which it was set out to do. Watch the text. Watch the text. It's kingdom alignment. I said kingdom alignment. To whereby by the kingdom of God, an adjustment is happening in the earth realm. A changing of the guards. A realignment of what's right and how it's supposed to be. Watch. Bible says, he goes and he says, listen, every valley will be exalted. How do you bring a valley up? Every mountain shall be made low. There has to be an adjustment in the earth's axis for an adjustment to happen. In order for the earth to shift, an earthquake is required. And for many of you, because you see the earthquake, you're afraid because it's chaotic. But God uses the platform of chaos to elevate his people. God, I was slow one time too. Lord, help me. I wish I was a better preacher. God uses chaos to be his stage to bring you out and say, look what the Lord has done. So when you see kingdoms falling, when you see businesses falling, when you see stuff start going crazy, when the government starts shifting, that's when you're supposed to start shouting, because the kingdom of God is coming through. But it requires chaos before his entrance. On scripture, in the beginning God created heaven and earth. The earth was without form, darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the earth. When Jesus was changing the trajectory of the spiritual climate, the Bible declares when he was on the cross that an earthquake hit, and the men started saying, surely this is the Son of God. The earth started shaking, the moon turned dark, everything started going chaotic. They didn't know what was going on, but what was happening was the Savior was in hell kicking the devil. But and that's why there was such an uproar. So when you see uproar in the earth, it's that God, it is the God kicking the devil behind and bringing an alignment. So next time you hear bad news about what's happening in the world, volcanoes an issue, just go to shout it, because he is aligning. It's a divine adjustment. When the weather is wacky, it's a divine adjustment. I'm not scared. It's a divine adjustment. Watch this. It's kingdom alignment. It's number three. The Bible declares, he goes and he says, watch this. Crooked shall be made straight and the rough places plain. Crooked is going to become straight. What was hard to navigate through, I'm prophesying. I'm not,
I'm not calling your name and your social security number, but I am prophesying. It was ways that it was hard for you to navigate through. It's going to be a straight line. This is number four, what I call the aftermath. No, not Dr. Dre record label. I'm talking about the aftermath. That after the dust settles. He says, the crooked way is going to be made straight and the rough places plain. Why? So that you can navigate without turbulence. So that you can function without interruptions. Can I prophesy to you? All of you who have been seeing interruptions while you've been trying to do good, I'm prophesying. When you're trying to go forward and it looks like it just the bottom falls out of it, the aftermath is after this, it's not going to be difficult for you to do what's right. After this, the righteous will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. What I'm trying to tell you is this is getting ready to be the season of the righteous, the season of the righteous, the season of the righteous. Watch. The Bible declares, he goes, I'm getting out of here, and he says, listen, the grass withers, the flower fadeth, but the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon thee. Check the text. Surely the people is grass. This is what I call number five, the deliverance from people. What do you mean by that, Apostle? Look at the text. Psalms 37, just write it down. It says, fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against them and their work of unrighteousness. This is the part I like. For they shall soon be cut down like grass. The people is grass. When he's talking about the grass, he's talking about people. He's talking about folks who don't like you for no reason. Folks who interfere with you for no reason. People who can make you give up and throw in the towel. Here is where you need a deliverance from people and their opinions of who you are. Their perspective of you. Their lies about you. I'm preaching to somebody who have a problem with people. You're not going to have to be afraid to walk in there with your head up and your shoulders back and say, I belong here regardless of what you think. You didn't leave that job because of the building. You left because of the people. You didn't leave your last church because you couldn't stand the building, the edifice. You left because of people. People have been the entrance of your rejection, your going the wrong direction, your making bad decisions. It's been people. But you can't get away from people. Because it is people who will try to bring you down, but it is people who will lift you up. It is people who will speak all ill against you, and it's people who will sow into your life words of affirmation. It's people. So if you hate people, if you hate the people who done you wrong, then you're going to have a problem with the people who are going to lift you up, because the Bible declares that men shall give unto your bosom. So I'm trying to help you just to get over people. I just love everybody. I don't have a problem with anybody. I don't care if they don't like me. Hey, how you doing? Hope your day is amazing. I don't care about you talked about me. I don't even want to know what you said. I stand right here because your words can't affect me. God bless you. I pray the best for you and everything in your life. You know, I can't stand that preacher. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm grateful for you, you, and you. Why? Because I can't let nothing interfere with what God is trying to bring in my life. And if I let you cause me to have an ought against you, then I got to leave my gift at the altar. Especially if you just grass.
He says, don't fret for the grass. It's going to be cut. Because I found out that when you put your mouth on people, and I ain't talking about nobody, I learned from personal experience. I had a problem with my former pastor. She's passed away just because I felt like some things weren't right. I tell this testimony every time. It wasn't even bad stuff. I just said I felt like it wasn't done right. They could have did me better, this, that, or the other. Every time I start talking about that, hell break loose in my life. And I didn't catch it till about the sixth hell. About the sixth hell, I said, this is crazy. If in my own car, nobody in the car, just me, God, they didn't do me right. He didn't care whether it was to people or to yourself. I just got you. Because for many of you, you don't say nothing to them. You just talk about them. I can't get no help. Stay right there. If it's under your breath, if it's whatever, you just be in the car by yourself. God don't like them. God takes record, and it brought hell in my life. And I say, God must love this woman so much that he ain't even going to let me talk about her to him. And when I stopped, the hell ceased. So I ain't talking about nobody. I'm talking about me. I closed my mouth. Did you see what happened? I'm shutting my mouth. I'm praying for who got hurt and the one that hurt. I'm shutting my mouth. Why would you do that? The Bible says, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. He didn't say we will repay. He said I. And can't nobody whoop nobody like God and it be all right. You whoop them, you going to jail. God whoop them, it is what it is. I need deliverance from people and their opinions of me and their perspective of me. I know how it feels to be a people pleaser. I know how it feels to want folks to like you. I know how it feels to have a problem when people have a problem with you and you're trying to make it right. If I did something I was supposed to do, please forgive me. I'm sorry. And you done did that 7-8 times. I know what it feels like to need somebody to accept me. Yeah, I know when you're quiet, I'm hitting you right in the gut because you can't talk about that because you tell everybody else you ain't thinking about them. But deep down inside, you wish they would. I know the feeling to tell one person, I ain't studying them, but then go in my car and say, God, why? I know the feeling to run my mouth in one arena, but then want them to be in my life in another arena of my life. I know what it feels like to need people to accept me. And I had to get delivered when I found out that there was no pleasing to them. When I found out I couldn't please them, if I did what they wanted me to do, they still had a problem with me. If I didn't do whatever, they still had a problem. And I found out that I need to please two people, God and myself. And I realized that I start choosing me, I got over the way that they perceived me. Bible says, as I get to close, the Bible says, he said, they are grass. Flower fade because sometimes the person that you want God to get, he already got them. I love the movie. Watch the movie Malcolm X, and after his life had changed, he goes back to the gangster who was chasing him and going after him. You should watch movies. You shouldn't be so deep. You should watch movies. If you don't know the movie, then don't worry about this story. You should turn TV on sometime. You ain't going to go to hell. So I'm watching the movie, Malcolm X. He comes back to the gangster, and the man had a stroke. This once gangster who was trying to kill him was feeble with a stroke. And it was at that moment he realized
that he'd already got. There's no need for me to fight my own battles. I'm staying here for a minute because I'm trying to help somebody who is struggling. You keep trying to fight for yourself. And as long as you keep fighting, God can't fight for you. But when you get out the way and be like Moses, God was getting ready to judge the children of Israel because of what they did. Moses say, God, don't kill them. Take me instead. He said, Moses, for your sake. That's really when the love of God is in your heart. When you can forgive and face your abuser. I'm going somewhere. Because you ain't gonna get what's coming soon with that stuff sitting in your heart. Text says, it goes in the Bible, says in verse 29, he give power. After he talks about all of this, that they are grass, he goes to verse 28 and says, have you not known? You just look at your neighbor and say, do you know the God I serve? That's the wrong neighbor, because you think he loves you when you do right. But Romans said that he commended his love to you while you was yet sinners. So before you even knew he was good, he was still being good to you. I wish I had three people. Before you even knew he was going to make a way, he was already making ways for you. Do you know the God I serve? Has not it known? You must have heard. That the creator of the ends of the earth, he don't faint or get weary. He gives power to the faint. Notice the text. Who gets the power? No, not the strong. Who gets the power? For those who done fell out. This is my point. You don't read the Bible. You think this is number six. Is watch this. You have to lose it. This is for the strong people who try to keep it together. It's not going to happen for you until you faint. Just fall out. Just quit. Just throw in the towel. You keep holding the towel. He say, throw it in. As long as you hold it, he can't fight. It's throw in the towel. Do you know in a boxing match, the referee will let you get your face tore up until your manager or your trainer on the side, when he throws the towel in, here comes the referee to stop the fight. It don't stop till you quit. Some of you ain't never gonna get married till you faint. You're too strong. You ain't ever, because you're going to do a whole lot. You have to faint a lot in marriage. I wish I had some married people. You have to faint. You got to fall out a whole lot. You have to give up a whole lot. It's called compromise. You got to faint. Just faint. Just you win. You win. There have been several times my wife comes to, okay, you win. And then I come to her and say, what do you want from me? That's fainting. No, you ain't ready for marriage because you got to fight. You got to fight everything. Why your toothbrush over here? Why your shoes over here? Why you looking at me like that? Why you talk to me like that? Why you going through? Do you know you can't live with somebody for 30 years and not aggravate them? You're going to be aggravated. Stay single. Be like Paul. All the married people, we just faint. What you want to eat, baby? I don't know. You choose. You want Chinese food? I don't want that. I just faint. What do you want, baby? I don't know. You pick. You want seafood? I don't know. Last time I had. What do you want? I ain't hungry right now. Okay. Then I get something. And I come home. I can't believe that you went and got something and didn't get something for your wife. You know what I do? I just faint. You ain't ready for marriage. You ain't ready for marriage till you know how to faint. Fall out. Watch the text as I get ready to close. Watch the text. He said, this is what blew my mind. I'm getting ready to close. Verse 31. But they that wait. See, you shouting, you don't even know what you're shouting, but you're shouting for the wrong stuff, because to define that word wait in the Hebrew, Webster does not know how to define it. Tell you the definition of wait. To bind together. This has nothing to do with the English translation of this word. It means to expect. To expect. To look. Look for it. To hope. To expect. To waiting. Ever went to Cracker Barrel? I go to the Barrel of Crackers sometime. And I go there all the time. Right? So I go to order my food, and if there's a wait, they got some nice rocking chairs for me. No, I ain't sitting there passing the time. I'm not sitting there because I don't have anything to do. I'm not sitting there because I'm not in expectation. See, wait for you is to just go, oh, one of these days in the sweet by and by, eventually it's going to happen. No, I ordered the food and it should be here. If you told me 15, 20 minutes, I'm just sitting here with expectation for my food for you to come out and say your order is ready. That's biblical waiting. There ain't no winning any day now. When the sweet by and by. This wait means to collect, to bind together. So point number 7 is where I lost my mind when I was studying. I need you to write this down, and I need you to say it like you got power. Say, I want my stuff. I want my stuff. Nah, I need you. I need you to touch 5 people and tell them, I want my stuff. I want my stuff now. What are you talking about, Owens? Yes, I've been in this rocking chair too long. I want my stuff. I've been broke too long. I want my stuff. I've been hurting too long. I want my stuff. Let me shout for about 13 seconds. I need you to grab a neighbor like they owe you some money. Rock them and shake them and say, neighbor, I want my stuff and I want it now. That's the wrong neighbor. That's the wrong neighbor. You gotta move out your seat and find you another neighbor like they owe you some money. Slap high five with a neighbor and tell them, neighbor, say, I want my stuff. Say, I've been waiting long enough. I've been giving long enough. I've been shouting long enough. I've been dancing long enough. But I believe in the year of the Lord's 2024. That I'm gonna get my stuff. What I've been waiting on for a long time, I'm expecting to happen, and I expect it to happen right now. Slap high five with a neighbor and tell a neighbor, say, get ready, get your posture ready, get your praise ready, and I want you to shout like it already hit your bank account. I want you to shout like it already hit your body. I want you to shout like your children already woken in the prophetic word of the Lord. Is that the best you can shout if it already manifests? I need somebody to holler. I need a screamer. I need somebody to jump. I need somebody to run. I need somebody to shout. I need somebody to give him glory. This is who I need to praise. Those who've been struggling for a long time. I need you to open up your mouth and let a shout come out your belly like you've been in the rocking chair too long. chapter 2, that it is about to happen. It, if I've never prophesied to you, it is coming. What do you have your faith on? Be 2 minutes to testify, and we're gonna have to have it another day, because it's gonna be 2 minutes to testify, and we're gonna have to have it another day, because it's gonna be 2 minutes to testify. I declare healing. I declare deliverance. I declare manifestation. What you've been waiting for. But they that wait upon the Lord, they that collect, expect, grab, shall renew their strength. And you're going to mount up with wings as eagles. You're going to run and not be weary. You're going to faint, walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord for you. It's going to happen. Get your heart in position so that you be able to help somebody else. So thinking the importance, the rag you got, the importance of Psalms 41 is an amazing scripture. It says, when you consider the poor, he promised you some blessings. He said, you won't lack. When you're on your sick bed, he'll raise you up. All things well for you. I want you to think about somebody tonight. It's going to be in the 30s. People who don't have, can't eat yet. You might want to go by a store and buy extra socks, blankets. Go help somebody. So I can ball and impress people and do, I don't need that. I like the car drive. I don't need that. I don't have to show this, that, or the other. I was happy in a broke down car that I had to put water in all the time. Smoke coming out the pipes because of the oil burning on the engine. I was the same guy. Does not matter. I need to be wealthy so that I can help people, change people's lives. And until your mind and heart changes to that, God can't trust you to bless you. But when you think like that, there are things I do. There are certain times I don't get a check and didn't get a check so that the people I've hired can get a check. Time. I don't want them to not get paid. God.
God will take care of me. During the pandemic, I didn't fire our musicians and they weren't playing no well. We didn't have service. Because I knew they had livelihood. When your heart turns, then God says you are ready. If you're just trying to bawl and trying to prove to your sister you was better than her and trying to do all these stuff, God's not going to. God can't trust you. You don't trust your heart. But I'm telling you now, God is about to try your heart. There's some things. Can he trust you with healing? Can he trust you with breakthrough? You shall eat the good of the land. You shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I declare that over your life. That good things are headed your way. I said good things are headed your way. In the name of Father, bless your people. Let your hand be upon them. Strengthen them and keep them. Move supernaturally in our life. We honor you. In Jesus' name, one last plea. If there's somebody here that's not saved, before we get ready to go, if you've never given your heart to Jesus, we can do that now.
No weapon formed against me. No weapon formed against me.
No weapon formed.